so this is a quick nutrition 101 for people who are interested in learning a little bit more about the reason behind so many different diets. Some work, some don't. So I want to provide a bit of background. So my name is Dr. Castano. I graduated from the University of Bridgeport this past year, 2017. Prior to that, I was at UConn. I studied nutritional science and psychology. While I was at the University of Bridgeport, I worked for a nutraceutical company called Biotics, and they basically do vitamins, minerals, herbal encapsulations, so I was able to learn a lot with them based on how different supplements work with the body. And I have my CrossFit Level 1 certification. I've always been interested in athletics all my life. I played hockey for 17 years, so I know what it's like to have different questions about nutrition and diet and so forth and how it correlates with performance. So, I want this to be more of a classroom type setting. At any point in time, if I get a little too technical or things are confusing, raise your hand, ask me a question, just let me know, because I'm sure other people are going to have similar thoughts. So let's start basic. What's a calorie? Technically, it's a unit of energy needed to raise 1 gram of water 1 degree Celsius. What does that mean to you? Basically, energy derived from food. So it's used to power activity, whether that be brain power, your thinking, muscle contraction, working out, this and that. But at rest, if you were to stay in bed all day, you would burn a certain amount of calories just by living and breathing. That's called your BMR, your basal metabolic rate. And the factors that influence your BMR are muscle and fat. The more muscle you have, the more calories you want to burn at complete rest. Fat has no caloric expenditure. It just pretty much hangs out in your body. If you want to imagine, muscle is more like an idling car. It's still going to be using gas to some degree. So if you want to have a higher BMR, if you want to burn more calories per day, you want to put on more muscle. So where do you get calories from? There are 4 different sources: fat, alcohol, protein, and carbs. For each gram of fat, you get 9 calories. For each gram of alcohol, you get 7. And then carbohydrates and protein are both 4 each. Now the interesting thing is that when you take in these different macronutrients, there's a different order of utilization. So your body will burn one first versus the other. Alcohol gets burned first. It's like throwing gasoline in a fire. Then you burn carbs, then you burn fat, then you burn protein. So the interesting thing is that you typically hear the colloquial term, oh, he has a beer belly. Not really a beer belly, it's the burger or pizza belly, because the alcohol is burned, and it's the pizza, it's the carbohydrates and so forth that are stored as fat. So what happens to these different macros when you eat them? Protein, predominantly responsible for building muscle, but it's also involved in hormone production. It supports the immune system. It makes enzymes that help produce different compounds in the body. And then, very lastly, it's converted to carbohydrates, which can be used as energy. Fat helps build every cell membrane in the body. It produces hormones. It aids in the absorption of different fat-soluble nutrients from your gut. And lastly, gets converted actually to carbohydrates and used as energy. Carbohydrates pretty much have one reason to buy, one purpose. It's used as energy, and anything in excess gets stored as fat. Does that make sense? So, quick note on protein. Fairly simple. You eat protein, gets partially digested in your stomach, and then it goes down to your intestines and gets broken down into the individual constituents called amino acids, the tiny little molecules that get absorbed, and then the body builds them back up into the necessary proteins, whether that be white blood cells for the immune system, enzymes to produce those different compounds, or muscle.
From that one, then, how can people add supplements of amino acids into their diet? Is it to kind of break things down faster or something?
So, amino acids, taken in their free form, taste like garbage, first of all. But they're able to help buffer the bloodstream when you're doing a workout that so say you haven't eaten for a while, right? You have no real blood sugar going on to be able to fuel your muscles. Your body will steal a bit of the protein from muscle, convert it to carbohydrates, and then you'll use that as fuel. So people take amino acids to make sure that the muscle is preserved, and then any proteins that would be converted to carbs are coming in from the supplement. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Or not.
To be honest, if you have a whey protein shake versus free-form amino acids, it's kind of a crapshoot. I mean, I think taking amino acids are completely unnecessary. Just have 20 grams of whey, you're fine. So, four different types of fat. We have saturated fat, monounsaturated fat, and the next slide is polyunsaturated and trans fats. It depends on the structure of how these fats are made up, but very simply, a saturated fat is predominantly solid at room temperature. Lard, bacon fat, fat on different types of meat, butter, cocoa. Right? Monounsaturated fat is olive oil or avocados. I know avocados are solid, but that's the exception to the rule. Then we have polyunsaturated fat, and that's where you get your fish oils and your omega-3s and omega-6s and so forth. And trans fats are the ones that you want to stay away from. The saturated fat, the monounsaturated fat, and the polyunsaturated fat, all healthy. Forget what you've heard about saturated fat being bad, and I'll explain why soon. Trans fats are the ones that you want to stay away from. So if you look on the back of the label and it says trans fat and has anything there, stay away from it. But also, you want to look at the ingredients, because anything that says fully or partially hydrogenated oil, if it's below 0.5 grams per serving, they don't have to put it on the list. They can say zero, even though there really is trans fats in it. Make sense? So, healthy fats versus unhealthy fats. Just a quick little synopsis. Pretty much anything in their free form, grown in nature or from animal sources, are going to be healthy. Trans fats and the unhealthy fats are the ones that you predominantly see when they're paired with processed foods, crackers, chips, candy bars, and so forth. Yeah?
What's a hydrogenated fat?
Yep.
If I eat a whole tub of Gourmet, that counts as a lot of trans fat, right?
That would count as a lot of trans fat. But if you look on the label, there's different type of... So the reason that the fat quality is important is because here you have a cell. This is pretty much every cell on your body. If you look at the outside here, it's the cell membrane. Nutrients go in through the cell membrane and weights come down. And the cell membrane, and this is the cross section here, all the yellow you see, is what that membrane is made of. That's fat. So the type of fat has a direct influence on if you can get nutrients into the cell and waste out. There are different channels that this happens. So if you're eating saturated fat, and monounsaturated fat, and polyunsaturated, all these good fats, the membranes of your cells are going to be able to work well. If you're having trans fat, the body sees that as basically being a saturated fat, doesn't know the difference. But the hydrogenated fats, the trans fats, get incorporated into these walls, and waste can't get out, nutrients can't get in. So what does this mean to you? Trouble losing body fat and fatigue. You're tired because you can't get the nutrients in to produce energy. So that's why you need to stay away from those types of trans fats. Make sense? So, omega-3s and omega-6s, these are the polyunsaturated fats that I talked about. Omega-3s predominantly are anti-inflammatory, and omega-6s are predominantly pro-inflammatory. I'll get to why in a second. EPA and DHA are the types of active omega-3 fats that your body can utilize right away. Those are the ones that are found in grass-fed meats and fish oil, or fatty fish like salmon. ALA is found in flaxseed and chia seeds, also a type of omega-3 fat, which is good. The problem is that the body has to convert the plant source of omega-3 to the active EPA and DHA. So that conversion rate is only about 5%. And in the process, it burns out magnesium, vitamin B6, and zinc. So if you're a vegan or vegetarian, only source of omega-3 are coming from plant sources, you gotta make sure you end up supplementing these things because you're gonna burn yourself out. Omega-6, you predominantly find in different types of vegetable oils and grain-fed meat, those types of foods. Yeah?
What are you eating your fish? Everywhere you get farm.
Good question.
Farm, whether you're out in the ocean or in the pool.
Yeah, good question.
And you get color.
So, most of the fish that you catch from the Atlantic seaboard on the East Coast is unfortunately contaminated with different types of plastics and heavy metals like mercury. So the only fish that I really advocate most people eat are Pacific wild-caught fish, predominantly salmon, sockeye salmon, especially if you're in here doing CrossFit. Because just the kind of pounding on the body, whether it be Olympic lifting or box jumps or this and that, it puts strain on the joints, and omega-3s help reduce that potential inflammation that can develop.
Yeah.
Whether that be in capsules or liquid, I would definitely, that's definitely one of my other.
So if you're taking that, let's say you're trying to do some structured diet, counting macros and all that stuff, do you need to count that at all?
Those are
fine.
Those are fine.
Okay.
Yeah. enjoy your omega-3 treats.
That's my stack.
Is it
Yes, so most meats are wild caught. You don't see like venison being corralled and fed grains, you know. So most of those in wild nature have a natural production of omega-3s in the body. So usually I would say most people should be getting 2 to 3 grams of omega-3s a day. So if you look on the back of the bottle and it says one capsule is 500 milligrams, you need like 6. But those are 500. Those are the ones you find at like Walgreens or CVS. Step it up a little bit like that, then you get one of that. Each capsule is basically 2 grams. So you take one. Yeah, exactly.
So it's highly likely that everyone here probably needs some sort of supplement of omega-3 because we're probably not buying, anyways, sockeye salmon, right? Or I'm not eating a lot of fats, right? So
exactly right. Yeah. And you burn through those types of fats more when you're active. So.
Yeah.
Where do you get sockeye?
Almost every grocery store you can find it. A lot of it's frozen, like flash frozen in the
food. Is that
alright? It's like sealed.
Yeah, it's actually, in most cases, it's better. Cause, I mean, you caught in Alaska, it's got to come all the way to Connecticut. I'd much rather have it just flash frozen than
that. I thought you were talking about like some Whole Foods.
They have it, but I've seen it at Stop and Shop, Big Y. Okay. And Sam's Club or Costco have it. That's actually the best place to get it.
Yeah.
Costco has a frozen section?
Yes. Normally, omega-6s actually are not bad. They actually are anti-inflammatory. The problem is that when the ratio of omega-3 to omega-6 becomes awry, which it is in the Western diet, that's when the spillover of omega-6 can be pro-inflammatory. So normally, it should be omega-6 to omega-3, 1-to-1. You can get away with 2-to-1, 3-to-1, 5. The Western diet is 15-to-20-to-1. There's way too many omega-6s. And where are you getting these things from? Processed foods that are made with soybean oil, sunflower oil, a lot of the Kraft vegetable oil that are just way higher in omega-6. So, lastly on fat, smoke point. When you're cooking food, who's like pan-fried different types of oils and started to see that smoke come up? So, we have everybody does that.
Right.
But olive oil, and you know, something like that. So what ends up happening is you take these healthy fats, and that smoke point is the point in time where the healthy fat gets converted into trans fat. So you can actually be creating it in your kitchen. So you can be starting off with olive oil or some kind of good oil. If you cook it too high, and it gets converted and it poses a health problem. So what type of fat do you use? The more solid the fat is at room temperature, be it butter, lard, bacon fat, so forth, the higher the smoke point. It's a more stable fat. So, coconut oil, you can get up to 450 degrees. Tallow, butter, lard, 400, 350, 370, respectively. You don't want to cook with sunflower oil, the least unstable. These numbers are a little high here, but the point is, the more liquid the oil, you don't want to cook with this. So even olive oil, you want to stay away from cooking in a pan, unless you're going to do it low and slow. That may have a higher smoke point. You can actually look at a lot of the ones that sprays, if you look on the back of the bottle, it'll tell you what the smoke point is. And then also just observe. If you notice it starts going to turn down the heat. Yeah.
What is ghee considered?
So ghee is clarified butter. Okay. So there's very little milk protein in butter. It's pretty much just fat, but there's a little bit. So if you were to take butter and you were to heat it up, basically bring it to almost a boil, then at the top of that pot, there would be basically a skim that you could That's the end parts of the milk. Protein. So you take butter, put it in a pot, heat it up. The milk proteins come out, skim that off, anything left is ghee. Clarify that. That has a much higher smoke point than milk. Right?
What kind of butter? Like salted, unsalted?
Doesn't matter. That's to make it yourself, or you can buy it in the store. It's more expensive, I would recommend it. Just
so if you bought it in the store, what kind would you?
And it just called ghee.
There you go,
babe,
write it down.
G-H-E-E. It's used in a lot of Indian cooking and stuff, too. So, carbohydrates. Two different types of carbs, predominantly. You have simple carbs and complex carbs. Complex carbs are things like sweet potatoes, beans, legumes, vegetables, berries, and so forth. They're usually with more fiber, which we'll talk about in a second. Simple carbs are crackers, white rice, chips, soda, fruit juice, candy bars, this and that. So,
that's who you have to watch, though.
All carbohydrates are broken down into glucose. So it doesn't matter if it's a complex carb or a simple carb, it goes down your digestive tract, gets broken down into glucose, and then it's absorbed into your system. Glucose looks like this. Imagine it is just a bead, right? Starch, which is a complex carb, is a necklace. So if you attach a bunch of these beads together, you have a necklace. And that's called starch. We'll get to why that's important in a second. Fiber is usually paired with complex carbohydrates. It delays the absorption of the carbs into the bloodstream. And there's two different types, soluble and insoluble fiber. It just basically means that if you take the fiber and you put it with water, does it create like a gel? Or is it just basically still flakes that hang out? The soluble type, the ones that create a gel, help decrease cholesterol, slow the rate of carbohydrate absorption in the digestive tract. The insoluble fiber gives volume to your poop, and it also helps feed the probiotics that are in your intestines. The probiotics then take the fiber and produce compounds that help produce neurotransmitters for your brain, improve your mood, and they actually have a significant effect, which I'm not going into now. But where do you find these? Soluble fiber in oatmeal, predominantly in flaxseed, chia seeds, and it's the type of fiber that's predominantly in fruit. Insoluble fiber is the outer hull of rice, that brown rice. It's basically like the more flaky, undigestible fiber. Make sense? Okay. When you're calculating the net carbs, because you can't absorb fiber, you have to take the total carbs that you end up consuming. Subtract the fiber, and that's the net effect. So say you're trying to adhere to 150 grams of net carbs a day, and you take in 200. If 50 of those are net are fiber, 200 total, minus 50 fiber, you hit your goal of 150. Make sense? Assuming that this is a piece of bread, 23 grams of carbs with 5 grams of dietary fiber, it only counts as 18.
Oh,
damn. Yeah. There you go. So the reason that this whole thing is important is just a quick note on digestion. Food goes in your mouth, goes down the esophagus, goes into your stomach. In the stomach, it starts to get broken down by the acids. When it makes its way into the intestines, all the different enzymes come in. Fat is broken down into fatty acids and absorbed. Protein is digested into amino acids and absorbed. And the starch that has this long necklace are broken up into the individual beads of glucose and absorbed. The rate at which the carbohydrates are absorbed influence how fast the sugar in your bloodstream spikes. So, glucose in your bloodstream, when I say glucose, I mean sugar, glucose, interchangeable. So when you eat a lot of carbohydrates, especially if it's a candy bar or some kind of fruit juice or some simple sugar, blood sugar spikes very quickly and you have a flood of glucose into your bloodstream. The reason that's important is because of these guys here. You have insulin, and on the other end of the spectrum you have glucagon and cortisol. They're antagonistic hormones. When that blood sugar spikes, insulin gets secreted. And the role of insulin is to act as a key. different cells in your body, be it muscle cells and fat cells, and it unlocks the door for these cells to take in glucose. Okay? So, insulin opens the cell, and then glucose can come out of the bloodstream and go into the cells. It happens in the liver, it happens in the fat tissue, and it happens in the muscles. When that happens, in the muscle cells and in the liver, those beads of glucose get put back onto the necklace. And in the human body, it's called glycogen. So you have this big necklace being made, and it's composed of a whole bunch of different glucose that can be used for energy at a later time. When it's put in the fat cells, it's not made into glycogen, it's made into fat. There's only a limited amount of glycogen you can store in the body. It's about 2,000 calories or so. Any sugar you have beyond that that you can immediately use for energy gets converted to fat, which has an unlimited amount of storage. That's
tell me about it.
So, quick note on this again. With the complex carbs, we have fiber. When you eat those carbs, your blood sugar spikes very slowly, insulin comes up, and then you have a very small rise of sugar in the bloodstream. Lasts a longer time. If you're eating fruit on an empty stomach, if you're having fruit juice, any of these other types of simple carbs, blood sugar spikes very quickly, insulin gets secreted and oftentimes overcompensates, and then you have a blood sugar crash and you create carbohydrates, you get hangry, you get fatigue, headache, brain fog. So that's usually what happens. Most people are getting tired at 2-3 p.m. in the afternoon. It's because they're on this basically carb cycle. Blood sugar spikes, blood sugar crashes, blood sugar spikes, blood sugar crashes. So the complex carbs delays that spike.
Yeah. So before every workout, I take a half a slice, lean sugar, just to get the blood moving and whatnot. So you're saying I get a high in my workout because of it, and then I get a crash afterwards.
So,
so
if you're having a little bit of carbohydrates like that right before a workout, it's not as bad as if you had it at any other point in the day because you're about to use those carbs, right? However, say you had a banana, right? Blood sugar spikes in the crash. If you pair that banana with peanut butter, the protein and the fat delays the absorption of the sugar. So that would be my advice. I never recommend anybody have anything fruit or simple sugar in it. Should be paired with fat. So again, this is just a quick little thing. The excess carbs, the beads on the necklace are being made. Liver stores 2,000 calories of glycogen. Beyond that, any calories, any carbohydrates that you consume that aren't immediately used for energy get converted to fat and stored in the fat tissue. So we talked about insulin. Those are things that build thing up, builds up the glycogen, builds up the fat cells, builds up the muscles. Now we have cortisol and glucagon. During times when insulin is not elevated and you're not eating food, cortisol and glucagon get elevated to increase the sugar in the bloodstream. From your day-to-day life, you're thinking, you're moving around, you're exercising. If you haven't eaten, blood sugar goes down. Your muscles are using the sugar that's there. How do you buffer the bloodstream to make sure that it gets back up with sugar? That necklace starts to be broken down, and a little bead will come off the necklace into the bloodstream. Glucagon and cortisol is what causes that to happen. It allows the glycogen that's stored in the body, that's 2,000 calories, to start buffering the bloodstream. It also helps break down the fat cells, so that the fatty acids that you have stored in your body can start to be used for energy. So you want to go a long, so if fat loss is your goal, you want to go a longer period of time between meals, so that insulin is low and cortisol and glucagon are high. Does that make sense? Then it means probably that you got to reduce the carbohydrates in your diet so that your body can get more use of burning fat. I'll get to that in a second. But it's also probably an indication that you're eating too many simple carbohydrates.
So lose fat for longer
periods. Mm-hmm. So yes, I have a little bit of a little slide on intermittent fasting, and I'll explain why that's important. So just a quick recap. Sorry. high blood sugar, you just ate food, tells the pancreas to secrete insulin, which brings the sugar into your fat tissue and your muscle cells and into your liver. During periods of low blood sugar, when you haven't eaten for a while, it tells the pancreas to secrete glucagon, which then liberates glycogen from the liver and raises the blood sugar. So, this is important because of the intermittent fasting. If you're constantly eating, snacking, grazing throughout the day, insulin is constantly high. Assuming that fat loss is your goal, you want insulin to be low, cortisol and glucagon to be high. That allows you to break down what you already have stored in your body. So, I advocate that people once or twice a week do intermittent fasting. That's where you eat in an 8-hour window throughout the day. So say you have your first meal at 11 a.m. You're finished eating by 7 p.m. The next day, you skip breakfast. You start at 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. You're eating in this 8-hour window. That allows insulin to be high during these 8 hours, but then you're breaking down what you have stored during the other 16 hours.
Okay.
If you're doing intermittent fasting today, yes. Yep, skip breakfast. And the workout will help deplete what you have stored in your glycogen in your liver, and you'll start tapping into what you have stored for body fat. If you eat right afterwards, great for performance, probably put on a little muscle or get it, but you stop the fat loss.
How big should those meals be?
The meals when you're doing the intermittent fasting. They should be normal size. You may be eating a little bit more just to get the same number of calories in. But I usually do it based on how you feel. The better you become at intermittent fasting, you'll find that it's like right now, if people are eating 5-6 meals a day, the idea of intermittent fasting is terrible right now. So
see a certain amount of calories in during the day to trick your body into not storing fat, because when you don't eat, it thinks it's going to starve, so it saves everything, to use if it doesn't eat again. So does that change over time, the mindset of that?
So the idea of eating frequently to keep the metabolism up, antiquated, not true. In studies, it's been shown that people eat less food when they eat more frequently, just because they're eating more frequently. They have snacks. People eat more food, typically, if they're left to their own devices, than they haven't eaten for a long time. But as you adapt to eating a little bit more fat, eating a little bit more protein, decreasing the carbohydrates, you go a long period of time without eating and be totally fine. That kind of
doesn't slow down the metabolism.
No. There's not slow down. I have a slide on that coming up. If you end up, I'll just tell you a little bit about it now. Say you want to lose fat, and you calculate that you burn 2,000 calories a day. You want to take, at most, a 500-calorie deficit. Right? Calories in, calories out still makes a difference. Burn 2,000 calories a day, and you want to lose weight, you're only going to eat 1,500. If you eat less than 1,500, the body starts to begin to think, crap, we're in a time of famine. There's some kind of starvation going on.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. So what happens is the thyroid gland, which is what controls all the metabolic processes of the body, it's what controls your BMR, your basal metabolic rate, how many calories you burn at rest. When the thyroid sees, holy smokes, there's no food in the environment, we're going to starve. It down-regulates. You become tired. You become fatigued. Because the body says, we're not going to burn through our reserves, otherwise we'll die. Okay? If you keep it at 500 calories as a deficit, you're fine. The body says, okay, well, there's still enough nutrients and so forth coming in. We'll maintain our metabolic rate as normal. The other thing that signals that the environment still has enough food is fat and protein. If you're getting adequate fat and protein, the body metabolic rate will continue as normal, even if you're at that deficit. If you're predominantly reliant on carbohydrates, and all of a sudden you're at a 1,000-calorie deficit, and no more carbohydrates coming in, the brakes are put on that thyroid gland. Metabolic rate increases.
How long do you actually run this intermittent?
So for people starting off the first time, I say try it once a week. See how you feel.
Just 1 day.
Yep, 1 day a week. And then bump it to 2 days. Say you do Monday and Thursday. Mm-hmm. Right? You'll notice that as you do this more and more, you're not angry as much. You don't have those carbohydrate cravings. You start having some crazy mental clarity. And even in the afternoon, you don't have that crash. You'll notice, you get better at it.
I'm never doing it.
So
Matt, when you're tying at some point how you're probably familiar with RP, right? So
yeah.
How RP actually programs us to eat a certain amount at a certain period of time over the entire day, and weight loss still occurs.
Because you're at a caloric deficit. The interesting thing, and I'll talk about this soon, is you had a question about why is it that some, like basically, you eat so many times a day, why is it some people can still lose weight and keep it off? It's about your ability to be able to tap into what you have stored on your body. And I'll just tell you. So in your cells, you have mitochondria. They're little organelles that basically produce energy. It's the powerhouse of the cell. It takes fat, it converts it into usable energy, and you're good to go. The number of mitochondria you have per cell directly influences your ability to burn fat. If you have one mitochondria per cell, it's going to be sluggish. If you have 50, you're going to be able to burn fat much faster. So what influences the number of mitochondria you have per cell? The amount of fat you have in your diet, and the amount of carbs. Carbs do not require any mitochondria whatsoever to be used for energy. So if you're predominantly having a diet that's 60%, 70% carbohydrates and a little fat, the number of mitochondria that you have start going away. You don't need them anymore. Once you take those carbs away, your body's like, well, I feel terrible. I have no ability to be able to use the fat that I have stored, so I gotta do something about it. So the body starts creating more mitochondria. And you go through this period called mitochondria biogenesis. Your cells start making more mitochondria. And when that happens, become massively more efficient at burning fat that you have stored. So you can take somebody who's predominantly carbohydrate reliant versus somebody who's predominantly fat reliant. Take carbohydrates away from both. The person who's good at burning fat is going to be totally fine. They're going to be shredded and lose a ton of weight. The person who's the carbohydrate dependent is going to take some time to get to that. But the intermittent fasting that depletes the carbohydrates helps ramp up the number of mitochondria you have per cell. And it allows you to become metabolically flexible. You can use fat and you can use carbs. Sense? So, quick note on cortisol. You might think, oh, well, okay, to require some discipline, if cortisol and glucagon are going to break down my fat, why don't I just go a long period of time without eating or have my cortisol be as high as possible? Cortisol is a breakdown hormone. It'll break down fat, but it also breaks down a bit of muscle. So you don't want it to be totally high the whole time. It'll stress immediately, running from Tiger, mental stress, like paying your bills and picking up the kids from school, but it also comes from over-exercise and doing a lot of intense activity in the gym. Like I said, excessive cortisol can break down muscle and redistribute it as belly fat. So, cortisol is good acutely, but you need to have some techniques in your life to be able to reduce cortisol. Adequate recovery time, meditation, yoga, some more of the rest and relax type activities. So, we talked about carbohydrate for performance and fat loss. Two times, really, are the best time to have carbohydrates in the day if you want to specifically improve performance and support fat loss. Remember that whole mechanism we talked about with insulin being secreted to unlock the doors to the muscle cells and allow glucose in? In the morning, you're very insulin sensitive. That means that your muscles and your fat both respond very well to the cues of insulin. You have a bagel, 50% of those carbohydrates get converted to glycogen and stored in muscle, 50% get stored in the fat cells. Immediately after a workout, those doors to your muscle cells are already open. They don't need insulin. So that same bagel taken after a workout will have 80% good glycogen and 20% good fat. At night, carbohydrates help convert the amino acids that are in your diet, the protein that are in your diet, to serotonin, which makes you feel good, happy, and satisfied. And then the serotonin gets converted into melatonin, which helps you sleep. So 2 times a day, I would say you have carbohydrates if you want to improve performance and have weight loss immediately post-workout.
Don't everyone start at 1 or 5 a.m.
It's okay.
Yep. Then you get the double weight. That means that during the other portion of the day, you can't be going buck wild at carbs.
I know.
It's the slides. Just the pictures.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's good to eat carbs at night.
Yeah, not go crazy. But if you're going to have a breakfast that is just eggs, kale, really not many carbs, no bread, no potato, anything like that. Lunch is a salad with chicken, and then at night, you have your potato or your rice. So you want to backload, it's called carb backload. You want to backload your carbs tonight, and if you work out at night, immediately post-workout, if you're working out in the morning, you have that 30-minute or so window where you can have carbs immediately after. It'll preferentially restore glycogen rather than being converted to fat and stored as fat. And at night, I'll help you sleep.
Does it matter how aggressive of a workout it is? Like, do you need to have full heart rate, like sweat pouring off you to have this breakdown?
No.
Occur, or
no,
it still be, you know, just pulse?
To be honest, resistance training is even better than bedtime for that kind of thing. You'll burn through more carbohydrates during the bedtime, you'll burn through them more, but the muscle cells will be open to the production of glycogen more if you do resistance training. Squats, pull-ups, handstand push-ups, those types of things.
If you have a day you work out more than once a day, can you eat carbs like all the time?
Damn.
within 30 minutes of finishing the workout, just so you can replenish that glycogen.
Okay.
In the muscles.
Second meals throughout that day, you're working out in the morning, heavy carbs on that.
So casein is just a slow digested protein. That'll help kind of help
right,
if you're doing intermittent fasting, no. But if you want to preserve some muscle mass, then it's fine. It's kind of a moot point.
Yeah, me too. Cyclically, 3 to 4 times a year, I advocate most people go on a 10 to 14 day ketogenic diet. Familiar with all? Does that name sound fairly familiar? Yeah.
So ketogenic diet is 60 to 70% calories from fat. Okay. So that's avocados, olive oil, coconut oil, butter, even animal fats. Okay. You want to get the majority of your calories per day from these fats. What do the fats do? Make membranes, make hormones, help repair tissue. Absorb fat soluble vitamins, everything we talked about in one of those initial slides. It's low in carbohydrates. Why? Because you want to deplete that glycogen so that your body has no more stores of carbohydrates in it, and it's forced to use another metabolic fuel. It's like switching from gasoline to diesel fuel. That increases the number of mitochondria you have in your cells, and then it allows you to be able to burn both. So say you start incorporating carbs back in after these 14 days. You can burn carbs. Fat. This is why some people can eat whatever and all of a sudden lose fat, be no problem. Whereas other people have such a difficult time burning fats because of those metabolic. Okay. The ketogenic diet resets that. It resets your metabolism, allows you to be able to burn more.
2 weeks.
Yep. Some people love it and they do it longer. But if you're coming in here and you're doing metcons, you're not going to do well on the ketogenic diet. I know. Kids with epilepsy are put on it for 2 years, and it's shown to be better than most any medication. And then they're taken off it, they're evaluated, da da da, and then they go back on it. So some people are on it for their entire lives. I've had a buddy who's a type 1 diabetic. He never leaves ketosis. His blood sugars are better than, to be honest, probably most everybody in here. It's incredible. Better than not, for sure. So quick note on the paleo diet. This is what I advocate to most people to start off on. The reason being, the idea behind the paleo diet is we look at the human evolution, where humans, as modern humans as we know them, were on this earth eating a certain diet. Only up until very recently has the advent of agriculture, grains, simple carbohydrates, refined carbohydrates, all these different things been introduced. Prior to that, for the vast majority of human evolution, it's been non-starchy vegetables, type broccoli type, collard greens, chard, and natural, non-hormone injected meat, okay? It advocates nutrient density. Nutrient density is basically how many vitamins and minerals do you get per calorie. A piece of kale, significantly more nutrient dense than a can of broccoli. It's anti-inflammatory, has those omega-3 fatty acids in them. And it has heme iron, which is the most absorbable type of iron. Iron is also in green leafy vegetables and so forth, but not very well absorbed. The best iron is from meat. And what's iron necessary for? Red blood cell production, the immune system, help fight off bacteria. And it's very high in fat-soluble vitamins, which are predominantly deficient in most Western diets. It's also low in things called anti-nutrients. So in different plant foods, predominantly grains, wheat, legumes, corn, soy, there's these things called phytates and lectins. And what those basically are like the sticky bandits. You guys see them home alone?
Yeah, of course.
Okay, so he goes in, puts his hand into the Salvation Army can, and comes out with a bunch of basically coins stuck to his hand. Same exact thing are phytates and lectins in the digestive tract. They bind magnesium, they bind copper, zinc, iron, all these different minerals, and prevent you from absorbing them. So you could be eating the most healthy diet in the world, but if you're having a diet that has a lot of these phytates and lectins in them, which are predominantly in wheat type of products, you're not absorbing them. Yeah, they bind proteins and nutrients, and they compromise those digestive enzymes. So you could. So yeah, so wheat bread, corn, soy.
What are you supposed to have?
So if you look, this is a little side note, but there's this dentist in the 1920s, his name was Ansel Keys, and he noticed that with the advent of these different types of simple sugars, candy, crackers, and so forth, everybody was coming in with dental cavities. Like, what the heck is going on here? So he became an anthropologist. He and his wife traveled for years throughout the world and went to all these indigenous populations in Australia and Africa, and he documented what the food was in all these different places. And almost everybody ate wheat, and they ate corn, and soy, and all these things. But none of them had them just from the ground, like they had them in the Western Hemisphere. What they did instead is they soaked the wheat, and they sprouted the different foods. And what those did was decrease the phytates and lectins, and then they were able to absorb the nutrients contained in these foods without the sticky bands. Does that make sense? So every single indigenous culture has some kind of method of preparation that usually involves some kind of soaking or sprouting. So if you take wheat, and if you're going to buy a piece of bread, I'd much rather you see that it's sprouted wheat.
So like
it's a good one. Exactly. Maybe not the best tasting, but yeah. It's just not as bad, actually, as you can check the back. Yeah. And also, remember, it depends on when you're eating as well.
Are those frozen?
They're frozen, right?
Yeah.
So are you suggesting supplements? The thing is that, again, we get back to nutrient density. I advocate nutrient density, which is as many vitamins and minerals as possible per calorie. You take vegetables, even potatoes, and you compare them to wheat bread, that has gluten, pretty much anything that has gluten. You're really not getting much from bread other than enjoying the meat. There's not many nutrients in it. Even for fortifying. Red potatoes are fine. It's good. Yeah, there's a good amount of nutrients.
Paleo. So sweet potatoes are paleo.
Yeah.
Now, I always thought white potatoes weren't.
So white potatoes are not technically. So paleo diet really advocates that you should eat any food that you can eat in its raw form. You eat a white potato, you're that. You eat a sweet potato, it's fine. Because it has certain compounds in it that need to be filled with.
This explains a lot. No, I'm just
kidding. One thing about, I guess, sweet potato compared to bread, does it still boil down to the macro, and if you eat over your macros, you're not going to lose?
In the short term, like calories in, calories out, fit your macros, all those things will have an effect. Over time, if you're eating white bread or whole wheat bread or any of these things with phytates and lectins, these anti-nutrients, versus something that has the same amount of carbs but doesn't have these phytates and lectins, you'll see a change. The person that's eating the phytates and lectins, the anti-nutrients, will all of a sudden start to be deficient in magnesium, B6, zinc, and all these things, and they'll present with problems down the road. This person is making sure that they're adequately supplied. Actually, you guys are spot on, right in the next slide. So, thermodynamics, calories in versus calories out. If you want to maintain your weight, it's got to be equal. You got to eat as much as you expend. If you want to lose weight, you got to expend more than you eat. And if you want to gain weight, you got to eat more than you expend. Simple as that. No matter what you end up eating, it always comes down to this formula. It's just how you eat that makes a difference.
How do you know how much you're expending?
So again, as I talked about, just a quick recap, setting targets and cutting it quick. If you're losing weight too fast or you're eating significantly more or significantly less than 500 calories than you're expending, you'll go into that starvation mode. Right? We talked about the thyroid downregulates. You go from a campfire to basically a match of metabolism. So, and here you are. Measurement and tracking. So, say you want to lose weight, say you want to lose fat. The first thing you gotta do is figure out how many calories you're burning a day. What's your BMI? So you can go to this website here, TDEE, Total Daily Energy Expenditure Calculator. Type in gender, age, weight, height, your activity, how many times you're working out a week, this and that, and what's your generalized body fat. This will show you how much lean muscle you have in your body, how much of that idling car you have burning energy, and it'll tell you how many calories you burn a day. Let's just take somebody who burns 2,000 calories a day, they're working out 3 to 5 times a week, they burn on average 2,000 calories a day. They want to lose fat, subtract 500 calories from that. Your daily intake is 1,500 calories. Okay. Then, you download this app, MyFitnessPal. You set your macros. Okay, I want to go on a ketogenic diet. I'm going to make my calories about 60 to 70% fat, 20 to 30% protein, less than 10% carbs. You set that up, you have your caloric intake, you type in what you have per day, and it will spit out if you're hitting your macros, if you're getting the right number of calories, and so forth. Do you need to do this every day? No. But do it long enough to be able to get familiarized with what's going in. Right? Say you say, okay, well, you know what? I'm pretty happy with my body fat percentage. I want to make sure I maintain performance. I'm going to do a 30-30-30 split. So 33% fat, 33% protein, 33% carbs. You plug it in, record your nutrient intake for the day, what food you're eating, and it'll give you this pie chart to see how you're stacking up. So that's where it becomes a little bit more individualized. I have to sit down with you guys individually, or you can do a little bit of research, play around, and see what works for you. Again, it depends in large part if the cells that you have a lot of mitochondria, and that goes on a symptomatic basis. If I tell you to do an intermittent fast and you want to rip my head off, well then it means that you're probably not that metabolically flexible. If you do it, it's no problem. Okay, fine, I'll skip this meal, whatever, no big deal. That means you can tap into what you have stored as body fat, and you're able to liberate that. It's able to give you enough energy to get by. Does that make sense? So it requires a little bit of self-tinkering in sort of the term. So I made a quick kind of sample meal. If you want to do a ketogenic style diet, breakfast, bacon, eggs, kale, cooked with butter, really, definitely go for it. That's the healthy fat.
Real bacon.
It's fine. You can have turkey bacon. It's not bad.
But you should still put this into like my fitness
pal. Yeah. That means you become familiarized with what your intake is.
So is that the bacon? Is that the same fat as the
peanut
butter?
Or again, peanut butter is fine. Again, you have to look on the back of the nutrition facts. Peanut butter is fine. Peanut butter fits into a fairly low carbohydrate diet. It's not much carbohydrate. Bacon is fine. Don't be afraid of real fat. We've been kind of fed this message for so long that saturated fat is terrible for you. It's going to spike your cholesterol. That is a conversation for another time. And if you're interested, please take my card. I'll email you the reasons why. But don't be afraid of saturated fat. So breakfast. I love the bacon.
Yeah.
You darn bacon.
Yeah.
I know. Ham's totally fine. Ham can get more protein.
No, ham.
Oh, ham. The thing is, like with the spray on oils, I'm not a big fan of those. I say just use real food.
They make like an olive oil one that's 100% olive oil, which is insane.
I got that one. But he says not the olive oil too much.
Pure olive oil has a higher smoke point than extra virgin. So if you look on the back of some of these sprays, I would stay away from the more synthetic ones. Anything canola oil based, sunflower oil based, those things like that. Pure olive oil, fine. But just take a scoop of coconut oil. lunch, some
do you
kind of thing.
Count that as
if you're doing a little bit, like if you're putting a tablespoon of butter in, then just throw the tablespoon in my fitness pal. Assuming that.
Yeah, lie to yourself.
So the thing is, one quick note on the ketogenic diet. If you guys decide, you know what, I'm going to try this thing for 10 to 14 days, you'll find that if your carbohydrate consumption is less than 10%, and you're doing predominantly 60 to 70% fat and 30% protein, I dare you to overeat. You won't. It is self-regulating. You will not be able to overdo fat and protein. You'll be extremely full at less than 2,000 calories a day. And then lastly, for dinner, say try out intermittent fasting. Do it for a day or two and see how you feel. If you find that you're like dying and you need food, then you're probably not as metabolically flexible as normal. The
just
idea
eight hours, just 8 hours per day.
Eating within the 8 hours and then not eating for 16.
Terry Crews does that like every day, doesn't he?
Yeah, I mean I was doing it every day for a while. You feel great.
Yeah.
You have great energy, you have mental clarity, you don't have that afternoon crash. It's because you gotta keep in mind too, it takes energy to digest and absorb and use these nutrients. Now you're going 16 hours where you don't have to devote your energy to digestion and absorption. It's devoted to repairing your muscle tissue, supporting your sleep, building up muscle, making you recover. So it actually liberates a significant amount of energy. You just gotta be able to tap into what you have stored in body fat as energy source.
So within those 8 hours, what
meals
do you eat? 3 or 4?
Once you become like okay, you just eat when you're hungry. But I would recommend starting off with probably eating 3 meals.
Your meals, so
yeah.
Like lunch, which is new.
Yeah, lunch, a snack, and dinner.
Okay. So then
yep.
Wait until like 4, 5, and then 8.
Exactly. Yep.
But you can still like do it where you hit your macros within those 8. You're saying like,
yeah, you
say
yeah.
15.
consultation right. program and all that stuff. So there's so in order for me to do a blood test, I need to have you physically down as a patient. I'm gonna be coming out with a different tiered system if you guys are interested in really having your handheld nutrition intake, specific macro setting, and if you wanna have your blood work run, that's gonna make that happen.
Exactly. How important is that?
It all depends on individuals. Truthfully, most people in here are going to be some semblance of healthy. Right? The majority of the people that I see in my practice are metabolically broken. They have type 2 diabetes, they have cardiovascular disease, they have strokes, they have stuff that they've left. With that being said, it is also very important.